Okay, Reem, we're going to be very short now. We're going to, hopefully, in October, we'll get a whole lot more. I just want to know this transition, not transition, what happened? Because you was one of the people who started the WBIX, which is basically WBI in exile. But tell us about that episode and the life of Pacifica radio station WBAI in New York.
So as the network, the Pacifica Radio Network, started to have way more Democrats under the Republicans, there were a lot of people that had different views on what community radio is about. And when the Democrats became in power, they were very uncomfortable that the radio network was really still doing what it's always done, which is to challenge the status quo for the liberation and self-determination of the people, particularly under the leadership in New York of Bernard White. We were much more Afrocentric committed, we were much more woke, and we wanted to do radio from the streets to carry the voice of the people. When he went down, when National Pacifica refused to cover the Palestinian March in Washington, D.C., and Bernard, as the program director, or was he the station director at the time? I
Program
don't
director.
remember. Program director decided to go down and cover it. He alienated a lot of, in my opinion, white liberals that were in California, many of whom could have been Zionist. It was uncomfortable for them. So they started the attack on WBAI. And then
Well, you have to remember, WBAI is a truly a listener-sponsored community station, which is different than a public station. Remember, a public station, basically under Lyndon Johnson, they started that a Corporation for Public Broadcasting. That was a political move, you see. So public radio, even when you go to things like NPR, that's all comes out of that stuff. Those are political kind of things. WBAI was more like, I don't know, I don't want to say libertarian, but it's like, hey, you know,
community radio.
we
You have a
have listeners,
following, you
right?
have a voice, you get space if you're bringing something to the collective discourse. And I remember, not to drift, but there was a some people that came and had an atheist show at some point. It doesn't mean WBAI espouses atheism, but they had a message that was different, that was interesting to add to the common discussion, and they brought in enrichment on the airwaves.
But see, that's always been in the DNA of BAI. But in the early iteration of BAI, you had guest programs. Like one time you had, I think, William Buckley, Malcolm X, and Ayn Rand all on the air at the same time, at different
Right.
slides. But go ahead. I really never think
So
about
we
WBAI.
were people came in, and they ch locks were changed, and a lot of the power at B of BAI was locked out of the station, and we started organizing the Pacifica campaign to not just reclaim WBAI but reclaim the whole network. Because people on WBAI had gone to California, including Errol Maitland, and by being lost and arriving late, he got a chance to hear a private discussion of the board that was talking about selling the network, about making sure that it is not the voices from the community voices that were there, basically watering down the message. They would shut down the Iranian radio show just as things were changing in Iran and in Texas and on and on. So it was all over the network. But for us in New York, it was they shut down the radio station. So people organized, and they organized with the listeners, they organized with some members of the local station board, with some programmers, and more programmers, with either being terminated, were being shut off the air, or they themselves get exiled. We realized that all these producers that are community activists needed a space to manifest, and we needed to keep a way to organize the public. After all, part of what WBAI was doing, that when they brought light on a certain issue, they got people walking in the streets and demonstrating and proposing solutions and opposing things. So they were also a mobilizing tool. So we coordinated with Washington, D.C., that had Indy Media, indymedia.org. And they were able to webcast, which means broadcast on the radio, which was a new technology. I was very techie. I mean, my formal training is in electrical and computer engineering. So somehow I found myself in the mix of it, and I was able to learn remotely how to webcast. Errol Maitland was used to be a producer of Pacific of Democracy Now. He was also a producer of Wake Up Call.
He's
the engineer also of WBAI, so his expertise was important. Jokesen Wild Horse. Tjokesen was a Native American that we met by organizing upstate with people from Westchester, and we felt it was important that we bring his perspective on the land, because my beat on WBAI, unlike other, wasn't that I had my radio show. I had a beat, occupation, repression, and a representation of the people. So I would go cover what's going on in the street and produce segments that aired on all sorts of different shows. So him and his girlfriend at the time, Amanda, and also a strategist with us that was on the down low was Dennis Moynihan, that strategically advised us on how to organize. So all the
Let me go back. So Tjokesen Ghost Horse had a girlfriend, Amanda. What was Amanda's
I don't remember her last name.
But what was her expertise?
They were Native Americans, okay. And she was, you know, a younger woman than me. And then there was Dennis Moynihan that was strategic. So the five of us brainstormed and came up with the fact that the event that everybody is organizing for, that I was learning the technology to webcast for the 21st of April 2001, was something that should become a webcasting radio. We should be holding radio shows. In the beginning, it was part-time, couple hours in the morning, couple hours in the evening, so as to keep all these producers busy doing radio before they get sucked into other things. And when we liberate the network, they won't have time to go into it. So this was the strategy that drove the creation of WBIX. Theater for the New City welcomed us to do the broadcast, and a lot of people were involved. It was brilliant. It was incredible. The other such interesting events that WBIX webcast were from the Shashama Theater, where weekly we will have other live events that were actually created to be broadcasted on radio. And that's how WBIX, WBAI in Exile, started as a radio network of refugees. And we also...
Refugees from the station.
From the station, and also... And the network. And we also... With the Pacifica campaign that donated us a bus that we converted, had a futon in it and all, we drove around the country to organize it, because it was part of the strategy of the Pacifica campaign to network with the affiliates and other strategic community radio stations, like some university radio stations. We taught them how to download sound from the internet. All of this technology was new at the time, so that we were able to distribute. And also we organized listeners through flyers, through word of mouth, through email campaigns, so they listen. Because really, a community radio is not just what's on the air. It's also who is listening. And later I ran into people that told me they used to coalesce around somebody's desktop in Brooklyn to listen to the shows. We had phone calls from elder people that said, I'm at the computer store, tell him what I want to buy so that I can listen to you. So it became a movement, and we were very aware of it. So we trained also people on doing radio. It wasn't just that we would carry their voices. We would also use the poor people's ways of having a three-way call, and the other one makes a three-way call so that we can have four or five people having a discussion on the air. We hosted a lot of the important shows. At one point, we even had a huge mixer in my living room, and it was hush-hush. Nobody was to tell my address in the Lower East Side. And even Bob Fass came and did radio from my living room. So we grew as a mobile radio station and also as a voice. And Errol and Joyce Jones did it 24/7 a day before actually 9/11 as an experiment while I was in the UK to see if you can carry it. I was also kind of a decider that, wait a second, we need to be able to carry what we claim we're going to do. 24/7 is a lot of work. Can we really do that? But by bringing Joyce Jones to help us, and later Reggie Johnson, Randy, so many other people of the community help run WBIX. Even Ursula, who now coordinates the affiliates radio station, learned and put a media on the air. We taught a lot of people how to do radio so that they tell their story, and so that we had a lot of ears and hands. And we actually did a contract with the first satellite internet service provider, Ricochet, and did a press conference before we had on the bus. And Pacifica Campaign, said, gave us that bus, so we drove across the country. So we did a press conference to say we're going to be broadcasting 24/7 from the bus, but Ricochet went belly up a week after the press conference before we took to the road. So we had to organize drop-ins from various places where we will go on their wired internet. And Joyce Jones would do the broadcast from her house in Brooklyn to keep continuity. We were able to bounce the source of WBIX content from her to us on the road. We trained the Aztec Mexica dancers in Ohio. We did rallies across the country. We went to Michigan to the universities and connected all of these various radio stations through the WBIX. We kept on going for a while.
Well, you go quite a while, because I know when I had my little incident with the sea, and I was in Washington, D.C., I even came by and trained some people in radio. I mean, that's, I'm just saying, the reach was longer than you think. I think at least 4 or 5 years, I think.
We were for a while. Then I became, I was invited to Washington, D.C. to help organize listeners there.
Yeah, that's when I helped.
Exactly. I was tasked with modernizing the news operation there, and we digitized it with the help of Indy Media in D.C. because it had a lot of techies. We found a lot of resistance from the local station. Some of the workers of the station there did not really understand what we were trying to do. They felt it's an invasion because we were really community-based, so we had a whole lot of people come in on the radio station. Tony Regusters, who appointed me and wanted to appoint me news director down there, but Dan Coughlin resisted that, claiming I had no formal journalistic training. Some of the politics that happen.
Well, most of the people in community radio don't have that kind of thing.
Well, yeah. Yes, but somehow it only applied to me. Yeah. Didn't allow me to take on that offer. But Tony Regusters wanted to give us room in WPFW so we could host WBIX. But it was a bit much because I was working around 120 hours a week. We had trained, you were part of the DC Radio Network, and we created the DC Radio Co-op with you, me, Rupert, who was with DC Indie Media, and a fourth person who I forgot who it was. And among the three of us, we created, three or four of us, we created the DC Radio Co-op that trained much more street reporters. Exactly. And to kind of alleviate the stress on the stations, we hooked up with the Youth Leadership Network and Doug Calvin in a church nearby, Old Souls Church basement.
That's right.
So we had a studio there, and the idea was to connect that to the studio. But what we were capable of in technically, we kind of lacked the know-how to navigate the politics of the Pacifica Radio Network. Yeah. And a lot of Zionists pushed me out of being so prominent.
Well, that's because you're from
WPFW.
Syria.
I'm from Syria. I'm Muslim. I'm a radical Afrocentric Arab. It was too much for them. And when I say that, I'm not saying it flippantly. We actually got emails from people on the local station board discussion that kind of indicates that this was the challenge, including people that were in the leadership of the labor movement and were pro-Zionist. So I was pushed out of the station. The community gave me access to a former strip club, and the place became People's Media Center, where we trained a lot of journalists. We produced national broadcasts for actually Pacifica, and we participated in many, many national shows, being the DC contingent from that co-op media center. WBIX would support programs and support projects that did independent media. So, for instance,
and we community helped community activism, basically.
Right, community media activism. We made brought a lot of awareness to issues of the FCC trying to kind of shrink and commercialize the internet, and we help fund people to go to Ferguson to cover the uprising of the community against police brutality there.
That was much later, though.
Right, yeah. Right. So well, every so often we would do such projects to support, and we helped a little bit support a film called The Color of Lawlessness about police brutality across the country. So
yeah, we're going to have to end it there. We'll pick this up in a couple of months, you know, other things, because, you know, you have a very... for lack of a better term, I don't actually like diverse or far-reaching influence in media and activism in the community. Thanks so much, Reem.
That's Reem Kathoda for Anthony Sloan.